So my son Sam is playing a drum piece.
Okay, it being 6 o'clock, we're going to start the board meeting. I do know some of our board members would like to get out here early for a concert, so at this point in time, we'll call the meeting to order. We are missing some board members, so I'm sure they'll be straggling in. This time, we're missing Kelly Kalsher and Ann Bauer. We have Linda Yu, Kirk Karbuski, Paul Kenny, myself, Bob Green, Superintendent George Gabrielis. Assistant Superintendent Sherry Syra and Director of Business Services Lori Ames is actually represented in us at the town of Middleton.
Yep.
Along with Bellinger as well.
Yep.
Okay. If the board doesn't mind, because we are missing a couple board members, I'd like to go a little bit out of order and we'll go with the recognition of Facility Planning Committee first.
Sure.
Sure.
All right.
All right. Come on.
Oops. As long as I don't. All right, now do we have, maybe we can get a picture or so we wanted to formally thank our Facilities Planning Committee members that are here tonight, well, all of them, and especially those that are here tonight. We began our journey September 2016, and then we're now May 2018, and our work is just beginning, as you all know, right? We got us to this point, and now it's the hard stuff, right? But we can't thank you enough. What an amazing group of people. I feel like I have 20 brand new friends, and I really mean that because we really came together. You were engaged, you did your homework, you asked tough questions, and you presented the board with outstanding suggestions, recommendations, which were then tested through Bill Foster's school perception survey. And tonight we're going to get the community's response to all the hard work that you've done up to this point. So I want to start by thanking our co-chairs, Bob Hesselbein, who is in Vietnam, cannot be here tonight, and Luke Francois. So come on up, Luke. And Luke is going to then introduce each of you, and we have just a little a pen as a token of our appreciation. So Luke, thank you so much for your co-facilitation, your leadership this year.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
All right, I'll in turn introduce those that have joined me on this journey. A year and a half later, we're rounding the corner, ready to finish, and it's been a great journey. I couldn't have asked for a better group to work with, so I echo your sentiments. Paul Brown, or Ron.
First off, it must be alphabetical.
You're welcome.
Random. It was my pleasure.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Great.
And just so anyone, we're saying thank you and all this. Your job isn't done yet. You're actually the hardest part is coming up as you're moving forward, just based on already the feedback that George and I are getting. There'll be a lot of people out there who aren't aware of all the hard work you've done with a lot of different questions. And just so you know, the community is still be different.
Ryan Hess.
Everything you've done. Switch it up. Thanks, Seth.
Absolutely.
Really appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you very much. It's been an honor.
Well, no.
It's been an honor to have you.
A lot.
And Sam Wilson.
We can bring these on Wednesday for those that aren't here.
A group of people, and for those that are not here, just come in, and I can thank them as well for their participation. This group really was participatory. They were in almost every meeting along the way. And that's what we were there. And together, we were able to do
again, if I could just say one more thing, if we want to go through the survey results, the very questions that you struggled with, the community struggled with. So I just want to say what an accurate job you did representing the community as you went through this whole journey. And that's really important to us as a board, because that was the question we were looking for to get the answer, is what does the community think? What are they looking for? And you got us to the point where we're very grateful, very much so.
Let's go around the applause.
Good.
The team photo on Wednesday.
I'm trying to get people out here early as well, too, so because that's Bangkok.
All right.
Yeah. A few more minutes and go to approval of minutes.
Sure. Whatever you'd like. You bet.
Yeah. We're moving a little bit out of order, and that's here waiting for two more board members. So. At this point in time, looking for approval of minutes, regular minutes of April 23rd, 2018.
I'll move. I'll second.
Any questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay. Communications, citizen comments. Anybody would like to address more of this time? Correspondence, board communications.
Yes.
Attended the spring concert in Glacier Creek, and the kids did an absolutely incredible job. It was wonderful to see the engagement of the kids as they were doing their performances, and just the progression in the short amount of time that the kids were able to make. Much credit to their instructors.
I went to the high school musical this past weekend.
Great job. Kudos to all of the theater, you know, the advisors and just, there's so many people involved in that, and it was just a dynamite show. So, and then this week is band concert week at the high school. So if you have free
we have some that are leaving actually at 7:30.
Is
early
it middle school?
Middle school
tonight?
Tonight,
middle tonight,
right?
Middle school? Okay.
So,
yep.
We'll do our best to move things along quickly.
I should have mentioned this last time, but we hosted a French student on the French foreign exchange program, and it was a wonderful time. It was great to welcome her into our home, and I know from hearing from the other parents, they were also very happy with it. We went to a Brewers game. We asked her, did you enjoy it? Yes. Did you understand what was going on? No, she said. It gave me a chance to dust off my French skills too, a little rusty, but I really got to hand it to the program. They did an awesome job, and I know my daughter is very much looking forward to the second half going to France in June.
Had a chance to go to the Clark Street visits on April 27th. Also went, like Sean, went to the Glacier Creek band concert. That was really good, like you said. Also went to the spring musical this past weekend, and I have to say the acting was so good and the storyline was so fantastic that I think Sherry would agree with me that it was kind of got almost choked up at the end. It was really, really good. It was good.
Myself as well as at Clark Street. The staff there was very accommodating, certainly learned a lot. We had Charlie Seaman, for some of people who may or may not know him, a former board member, reached out to George and I, and we're going to meet with him. He had some concerns. He's representative of some of the people in Cross Plains with some concerns, and George and I are going to sit down and chat with him. And he'd actually reached out to Bill Rice before he reached out to us. So, it is interesting as you're moving through the journey, there's still a lot of people out there who haven't heard of the work that you've done, and so now those questions are coming out a second time. So I think that pretty much covers where I'm at.
Can I say
yes,
one more
please.
Thing? I wanted to piggyback on something Kurt said, and that was the visit to Clark Street. I just wanted to say kudos to Jill Gertner. Oh my gosh, that program has grown and just become so much more meaningful. It's exciting to now go back several years after the first time that I can remember hearing about what she had in mind and the development of that program, because hearing how it's going to be sort of implemented into all levels, you know, and certainly at the high school level, is just gonna be very exciting for the district. So I just wanted to add that.
Just the enthusiasm of the kids too.
Yes, I'm sorry.
I just want to mention, I went to the teen depression and anxiety program last week, and it was a great program. The collection of professionals that they had, another eight or so, talking, they all had a little bit of a different subject area, but very complimentary too. Really impressive, and it was great to hear their talking about the district and all the resources that we make available to help with those issues in our school. Was really satisfying. Some about maybe 25 to 30 parents there, which I thought was a pretty good turnout. This wasn't the first time they'd offered this program, so to have that type of turnout, like the second or third time they've offered this, I thought was great. And a number of the parents also really just had great things to say about the staff in that area and the resources our schools make available. So I went as a parent, but to hear what they had to say. I've got four kids in the schools that have all those same issues. But it was putting my board member hat on for a minute. It was very satisfying to hear the parents talk about the district and the experience they've had here.
Legislative.
Sounds good. Yeah. As I put in the weekly update last week, this is Teacher Appreciation Week, so please be sure to thank your children's teachers for the amazing thing they do every day for our kids. Can't thank them enough, and I know we want to thank them every day, but this week in particular we want to highlight the great work they do. So happy Teacher Appreciation Week. Thank you, Jerry, for what you do. Looking, do we have any other teachers in the crowd? Thank your wife tonight, Ryan. Okay, so FPC meeting is Wednesday night. That's our final FPC meeting. That's at 6:30 right here, where we're going to kind of dive into the survey as a committee after hearing what Bill tells us tonight, after hearing what the board tells us tonight. I did want to clarify, you know, Luke asked the question, Bob and I talked. Is there a recommendation that will be coming from the FPC after Wednesday, and your recommendations were reflected in the survey. That's when you said, here's what we're recommending, let's build a survey around that and get our community support. Because now, what we've heard over and over is now we have to listen to our community. And what Bill will share tonight is what our community tells us, and that becomes our guide. And so really what we're gonna do both tonight and Wednesday is to kind of to take a step back, look at where our community stands on all of these, and really a lot of celebration. You'll see that here in a little bit. So Wednesday night at 6:30 will be our last official FPC meeting.
George, before you go on that, I mentioned just briefly, I've learned in the past from past surveys and then from past referendums, if somebody asks a board member a question and I ask the FPC a question, or if they ask the janitor a question, I can tell you who they're going to listen to in terms of answers. Not because we lack credibility, but with the community, since you've been working on it and you made recommendations to the board, your voice is much louder and much clearer than our voice is. So while the meetings may end, your role as moving this forward will certainly not end. And the fact that you've had all these discussions, what the board didn't have all these, we've had discussions, but not to the degree that you have, you have the ability to answer questions in a much different way than the board will ever be able to do, which is a much cleaner and more authentic answer. So I want to thank you, and I'm going to apologize that your journey won't be finished even when the meetings do finish. But again, I want to thank you for what you've been doing for our school district.
Can I just ask a question about that? I understand there's no recommendation coming from the FPC and that we've already kind of gotten that. I'm just hoping if there's some insight that their group comes to on Wednesday night, there's a way to share that. I mean, they've been in the weeds so long and have worked so hard on this. I'd love
to have Luke come back as well as anybody else. I mean, no different than any other group or committee we've had. Certainly we'd like the chair to come back and echo that. But if there's an individual voice who would like to be heard and may not feel they're being heard, you know, through the chair, we will certainly want to hear that. I mean, you guys have spoken very well with a unified voice, but any feedback you can give us, we can set that up in the next meeting.
If we could just have something where if there's something in particular they'd like to make sure we understand, because they've been in the weeds for so long, I'd love to have that perspective.
Luke, what's your schedule like?
He's not here on the 14th, so 21st you can come.
Is that okay with the board?
Because it's already on the agenda for the 14th and the 21st.
So 21st. Thank you.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay. We'll move to consent before we go to the next one. For offer for your consent. Administrative Business Services, approval of bills payable. B, approval of resignations as well as the addendum on your desk. Approval of leave of absence, there's addendum on your desk. Approval of staff appointments and that's the addendum as well as approval of retirements. And then we also have the approval of foreign travel, China, Greece, Spain, and Vietnam. Wow. Looking for a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any items that would like to be pulled from this for further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay, I think before we move any further, it looks like we're going to make two board members with the board. I'm going to ask George to take over this particular point.
Okay.
Move to election of board officers.
Election of board officers. At this time, I am asking for nominations for board president.
I nominate Bob Green.
Second.
Are there any other nominations? Not hearing any. All those in favor of Bob Green as president?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, Bob, meeting's back to you.
There you go. At this point, we'll continue on looking for nominations for vice president.
I nominate Annette Ashley.
I'll second.
Further nominations? All those in favor of Annette Ashley?
Aye.
Aye.
I'm slow sometimes, sorry.
Didn't have the conversation earlier.
No worries. At this point, we're going to move to clerk. For clerk, looking for nomination.
I nominate Todd Smith for clerk.
I'll second.
Nominations? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you for serving again as well. And last, we'll move on to treasurer.
I nominate
Linda.
I second. Thank you.
Any further nominations? All those in favor of Linda Yu, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Linda, thank you for serving as well. Much appreciated. All right, at this particular point in time, we're going to move on to agenda items, items for information, discussion. All right, meat and potatoes. School perception report on community survey results. Actually, before we go on this, can we get the two action items out of the way? And then that way we can just concentrate on those two, because that way we might be losing some
That's
more.
That's true. Good point.
Okay, so my apologies. Start here. Approval of 2018-2019 individual teachers contracts. Looking for a motion to approve.
Yep. Before we go any further, Tabitha, I wanted me to remind you that the one resignation that was on the addendum will now be removed from that teacher contract.
Okay.
As
you approve it. Okay, so we will be looking for a motion with that addition to that. For a motion.
So moved.
I'll second.
Does anybody need any clarification on what, okay.
So for the record, we're removing Fred Hartman from the contract list.
Okay.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Okay, it passes unanimously. Oh, do we need to do a roll call on that?
You don't need to, but you can.
All right, I think as we talked about this is an important item. We're going to go for a roll call. Linda?
Aye.
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 Thank you for that. My apologies. Approval of Godfrey and Kahn payment.
So moved.
Second.
Participating.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay. Just get that out of the way because we do have some people leaving early and that would could possibly leave us in a shortage. Okay. Now we're back into consent items. Consent. So it won't require votes. So if we don't have a quorum, we won't be in an issue of problem. Bill?
Come on up, Bill.
Can I sit here and then I can see the...
Oh, sure.
Does that work?
Yeah. And so same thing here for board members on this side. If you want to be able to see the screen, you can either turn around or feel free to move on over to the side. So Bill Foster from School Perceptions, it's always an honor and pleasure to work with you. We have a long history with Bill and School Perceptions. We also do the staff survey. We're talking to you about our student engagement survey. I don't know if you even knew that.
Good. Well, thanks for having me tonight, and it's good to be back again. I guess I just before we start, last time I was here, we spent about an hour with the board writing the survey together, and then actually, after that, we went and worked with the FPC, and they really did a great job. I mean, so I just want to acknowledge that group for your work, because we think we're brilliant when we write the survey, and then people that have been working on it say, well, have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? And it actually got better again after the second hour of survey review. So thanks for that. Again, I'm Bill Foster with School Perceptions. My job tonight is to take you through the data and see what the survey says. So the survey went out in April. It looked like this. It got mailed to every household. As of this morning, we retallied the results. We have 3,382 responses. 812 came back via paper. I think the board might have saw in your board packets a last week's version that had a few less surveys, but we're up to a participation rate of 18%. From a statistical standpoint, we have a margin of error of down to plus or minus 1.7%. If we get another 1,000 surveys, it might drop down to 1.2 or something, but it's solid. You've got very, very good data. So who took the survey? First question was a demographic question in terms of age. Here we want to look at, I mainly look at 65 and older to make sure our seniors are well represented. And when we go back to 2010 census data, we're at about 16.8. So I think our seniors are represented in that data. Do you live in the district? 89% of our sample, in fact, live in the district, with 9% saying no and a few not sures, which raises the question, who are those 9%? Who are those people taking our survey? And the answer is primarily staff. We asked all staff to participate. We will remove the non-resident from the financial support question. It was important to have staff participate, but when it comes to voting, they won't be able to, so we don't want to represent them in the data. In which city or township do you reside? You can see we had representation from all the various municipalities, with 44% from the city and 20% from the town of Middleton. And I guess I'd ask the board if that is representative based on kind of what you know about the district. Is that?
Yeah, that's pretty representative. We double checked.
City of Madison might be a little underrepresented.
Yeah, that's one area where we might pick up more votes is City of Madison.
12%.
Yep.
All right. So of the sample, 17% or 545 folks were staff members. 54% of the sample were parents, and the remaining 46% were non-parents. Now, when you look at the sample in total right now, it's overrepresented with staff, overrepresented with parents, and underrepresented with non-parent, non-staff. To remove that bias, we will create three mutually exclusive subgroups. We'll get to that in just a second. For the parents, if you have school-aged children, please check all the grades that apply so you can see we've got some elementary parents, middle school, and this adds up to more than 100% because you could have a child in multiple schools. We did not, but we could cross-tab the data by this information. Overall, what impact do you believe the Middleton-Cross Plains Area School District has on your home value? We're at 70, boy, it's so good that you're off the chart, literally. 77% are positive, 11% little to no, with only 3% impact. We use this is not necessarily a norm question, but we've used this for many, many years in many, many districts. This is probably the best I've ever seen, okay? And this has to do with whether or not, you know, if you've got a home, even if you don't have kids, is the Middleton-Cross Plains School District an asset? The answer is yes in this case. I worked with one school district where the negative impact was 67%.
Oh.
That's harder information to share with the board than this information. So it's really, really positive, so way to go. Next question had to do with communications. How would you like to receive information from the district? Here we thought it makes sense to take out the staff completely, because we've got our own modes of communication with staff. So the parents are in blue. Their number one is email. Number two is district mailings. Go to the website third. And then for our non-parent, non-staff, their number one is still district mailings, with the Middleton Cross Plains Times Tribune at 38%. And I did go back and looked at, I think it was the last survey we did, we were at 46%.
Question,
yeah. So it's dropped from 46, but it's still 38%. So okay. It's still over a third of the folks are still reading that paper. I think there used to be the was it Perry, the news sickle or something like that?
Yeah, they've combined.
Okay, so there wasn't it perfect apples to apples, but and then 31% are reading the Wisconsin State Journal. George, you don't have to be tweeting much these days, apparently.
I actually deactivated my Twitter this time. I wrote to, I'm just tired of Twitter, but man, that's a whole nother topic.
Activated first and deactivated.
I had one.
So then, I did put this in for the 2008, and this wasn't perfect. I just kind of wanted to look at the district mailings, how things are moving. And actually, back in 08, I really was interested in the social media, and we didn't have any social media back then. So we didn't have Facebook or Twitter or anything else.
So does that mean we didn't do a survey in 2012?
We did one in, I did one in 08.
What year was that, 09 or 08 or 09?
08, 09, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, we didn't do one before 12.
Then we go to the heart of the survey, the facility planning background. So when we created the report, we took the excerpts from the background information, actually put it in the report so that this thing can kind of stand on its own. So if a person were to go to this on your website and say, what was the background information? We talk about the insufficient capacity and outdated classrooms and so on and so forth. That sets up the question, what advice would you give the district? Here you can see it says residents only. Again, to remove any bias, we look at staff as the first group. They're at 92% saying pursue a referendum. Parents are the second group. They're green. They're 86%. And the non-parent, non-staff, we call those people the purple people. They're the most important because they literally have the most votes. So when it comes to voting, I think Andy from UA did some analysis, and he came up with about one-third of the residents in Middleton are parents, so about 68%, and two-thirds are 32% are parents, and the remaining are the non-parent, non-staff. So when you look at this, you kind of want to weight more to the purple than to the parents. And then I do want to mention the staff, though, they're extremely important. Even though they get less than 1% of the votes, if the staff aren't on board with this project or they think it's a bad idea, they literally have thousands of conversations every day with parents, with friends, with neighbors, and if they're saying this is a dumb idea, sometimes it is, then your Perry can't write enough press releases to catch up with that. So kind of the first headline of this thing is a majority of all subgroups, a strong majority, are saying pursue a referendum. So we go to the first component being the high school, arguably maybe the most pressing need. We share the enrollment that's growing, as well as the plan that was proposed. It was a $94 to $104 million plan that shares not only the description but also an image. And then the question, would you support a referendum that provides funny update and expand the high school? Again, residents only. And again, the conclusion, a majority of all groups are saying yes, we're supportive of that. So 53% of our purple people are non-parent, non-staff, almost 2-to-1 support, with another 18% undecided. Our experience is we're not as concerned this time because you've got already have a majority. But when it comes to voting, undecided typically bends about two-thirds no, one-third yes. My theory on this is in Wisconsin, people are nice, so they don't want to say no, so they say I'm undecided. But when it comes to voting, they tend to more go no than yes. So you would pick up maybe another 6% of that group supporting a referendum to fund a high school expansion and update. The next component was the elementary school, again, same format with the background information that was provided in the survey, an image, and we tested a $34.7 to $41.5 million project, and very similar results, actually. So staff, not quite as supportive, but still at 82%, 67% of our parents, and 53% of our non-parent, non-staff are saying, yep, we would support a new elementary school. Then probably the most complicated part of this was the middle school because there were multiple options. We actually had option one was to temporarily serve fifth grade students at the new elementary school. That's a short-term option, expand the creek. We could do that for $13 to $15 million. or the long-term option is, let's just go build a new middle school right now, that'd be 58 to 64 million. So again, we broke it into the groups, so the column on the right is the non-parent, non-staff, and here you don't have as clear a data, you know, they're kind of, it's kind of split, but the winner for the non-parent, non-staff is saying, let's delay that decision, they're at 34%. Option really 2 and 3 arguably are a tie at 29% and 28%. And option 1 is temporarily serve 5th grade students at the new elementary school. It still only drops down to 23. That's for the non-parent, non-staff. The parents and staff, they're on board with kind of going ahead right away. You know, their option 3, building a new middle school, that's the one that they favor. However, there's another factor, which is money. We've got to reconcile it with the money. We'll get to that one in just a second. There were 2 other projects that were tested. The first one was a cafeteria at Park Elementary. This tested well, really across the board. All groups, again, all subgroups are saying, yes, I would support that if that was included. And the outdoor athletic facility project up to $3.8 million. Now there, this one didn't have quite as much support. And you can see really across the board, staff were at 55%, parents were at 55%, and the non-parent, non-staff are kind of split with another 21% undecided. So at the end of the day, if that undecided splits 1/3 yes, 2/3 no, this particular project would have a hard time passing on its own. So then we get to the $220 million question. So we go from 100 million and we shared the tax impacts at 100, 300, and 500. So we tested 100, 130, 160, 190, and 220. And we created this colorful chart. And the logic with this is if a person were to support 220 million, arguably they'd probably support 190. If they're in at 190, they'd probably support 160, and if 160, 130, and if 130, 100. So this got a little bit wonky when we put it into whatever program we're in, that my 50% line kind of moved closer to 40%. So if you can in your mind move that dotted line in between the 40 and 60, what you'd find is the non-parent, non-staff, they're at really at 130, 130 million. And the parents are in at a solid 160 million, and the staff is in at 160 million. So again, 2/3 of the votes are in at 130, and then you could pull it up a bit with our parent vote. They're gonna support a little bit more, but at some point we're gonna lose our non-parent, non-staff, and they're the most important group. I think, oh, we have one more. So then we have funding for operations. So if we go out and build something, we're gonna have to clean it and maintain it and heat it and operate it. And that could range from 3 to 5 million, and that could have an additional tax impact of $53 to $89, depending on what would be built. And this tax would not start until the construction was completed. So it's a different kind of a referendum. And again, people are supportive of that. Better than 2 to 1 for non-parent, non-staff, and strong support for the staff as well as the parents. So it's really good news. And this is, so there will be, if the board decides to move forward, there would be 2 questions on the ballot, both having a tax impact. It's kind of important to remember, because when we jump back to the capital question, this is really 1 question, and maybe arguably before they saw the operational. So the second question on the ballot does not pull this up. It puts a little more stress on the capital question. So if you're feeling bullish on this, you have to remember there's going to be 2 questions on the ballot.
I've seen that in past referendums where sometimes one question will get answered yes, and then the operator will get answered no.
Absolutely true. It's the old, I went out and bought a fancy boat, but I can't afford to put gas in it. So you got to be able to build it and operate it. Historically, a long time ago, 10 years ago, capital referendums typically had about 8% more support than operational. Over the last 10 years, those have come together. They tend to be testing similar now in terms of support. I think people are starting to wrap their minds around that school districts actually do need funding to operate, where maybe 10 years ago they didn't understand that as well. It's just my theory, but the statistics are showing that they're kind of coming together in terms of support.
George and I talked to Bill a little bit about a couple things, but before we move on to that conversation, I'm sure there's questions that the board has. Questions that you'd like to address to Bill?
Just to clarify and make sure I heard correctly, so you're saying the non-parent, non-staff, or the purple people are 130 was the cap?
Two-thirds.
I'm sorry?
One-third's a cap on that group, right, yep.
And then 160 was the parents?
160 is the parents, right, yep.
So your recommendation, we talked on Wednesday, was that keep it in the 130s?
Yeah, I would be nervous. I think you're solid at 130, and then the question is, well, how much higher can we go, right? You know, can we push it? I'd be concerned going over 130 to that 140. I think at that point there's, I'm not a psychologist, but I think there probably is a psychological threshold every 10 million you go over. I do think you have to go back. I think the Findorf team will go back and say, okay, let's sharpen our pencils and see where these numbers really come in. That'll give you more information, but I'd be apprehensive to push it beyond that 140.
139, 138 would be your recommendation.
Is this a ceiling?
Yeah, I think in that 136, 137, 138, okay, somewhere in there, where it makes sense. I do have one story to tell. I think we had, in the last two referendum cycles, we had 56 projects go to referendum. The survey accurately predicted that 51 of those would be successful. In fact, those were exactly the ones we predicted were successful. There were five or four that we said would fail. The district decided to go out for something that didn't have support in the survey, and those in fact did fail. And there was one project where there was support at 25 million. The district went for 26.9, and they lost by 3 votes.
Oh, wow.
So the survey is predictive, and I always caution districts to try to push it just a little bit more. There is a limit. And in that particular case, we found exactly where that limit was. So that's for the what it's worth.
We put that through ourselves here through one of our referendums. But on the other hand, boy, I mean, there's been a lot of work getting to this point. Questions? Yes?
I have one. Is there a way to measure the intensity of the support? I mean, I think of things like gun control, where majority of the people are for it, but the people who are against it are highly motivated. And so is there a way to do that? Or is it even important?
Yeah, I think one way to look at it is if you look at the right side of the chart, if your glass is half empty, and you say, well, how many people wouldn't support any referendum whatsoever? Those folks are probably never going to move. In a typical survey, you might see 22, 24, up to 30% of a community of the non-parent, non-staff would say, never, ever going to happen. You're at 15%. So you don't have that intensity against this. In fact, there's a lot of people who are saying, I think we need to do something.
Okay. I think maybe a way to rephrase what he's asking is, is there a way to predict the turnout, the voter turnout within these subgroups? Have you ever followed up with that?
Yeah, and actually, our experience is, you know, the logic is, well, presidential is always the best. It's the highest gubernatorial, which you would be considering as second best. But my experience is this is a local issue, and people turn out for it.
One way or the other, you mean, those against and those for? Yeah,
they both do.
Okay.
They both do. And the people who take the survey have developed an opinion for and against, too. So if they don't know, don't care, they tend not to take the survey, and they tend not to vote. In the old days, we used to ask, do you normally vote in elections? And we were always at 92, 93, 94% of the folks who take the survey actually turn out to vote. So
you're saying just by virtue of the fact that they took the survey, is kind of that kind of bakes in the voter turnout within the survey itself?
It really does, okay. Yeah.
And on one thing, one of the WSB functions that I attended, they talked about, I think it was Barry Forbes had presented it, in terms of turnout for referendums, or may have been you, but party lines. Democrats have a tendency to support referendums at a stronger rate than Republicans do.
And so this being a highly contested election and this being a strongly Democratic area, I think at least we picked the timing right in terms of for the election.
That'll generally help you. If, again, if the project, if you've got the right project on the ballot. Although I would say, you know, if you take out Dane County and Milwaukee, there's still really strong support for referendums throughout the state when it's the right project, even in highly, highly Republican communities. But I would agree with you. I think in Dane County, where you've got a strong, generally speaking, what you said is true.
Go ahead, Tom.
That was a good transition to what I was going to say, which is I'm glad to get the recommendation and happy to see what the data shows as far as what levels, you know, that we have community support for, but it still has to be the right project, and there's still a ton of work to come, you know, to, I mean, they got a little bit of information about what we propose to do here, what the proposal will be, but I suspect there'll be a lot more information that comes up between now and November, and if we get the project wrong, you know, they may not support it at any level, so I think it's still a lot of work to get the project right.
Actually, right there with you as well, which is why I'm going to go back again and say thank you to the FBC. I think they did a fantastic job of winnowing and sorting through all the information, because at least the survey results at this particular point in time do indicate that you got it right.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes it much easier for us to start moving forward, because I know I've been kind of waiting for questions and concerns after the survey went out. And we've gotten one or two flags have gone up, but they're not big and they're not major. So, knock on wood, but so far it's looking like everybody's been doing their jobs correctly, and we just need to continue that effort.
I always like to kind of, while Bill's here, push Bill to, you do this for multiple years, multiple districts. Reading that, looking where our numbers fell, looking at the questions for the high school, the elementary, and the middle, your expert analysis.
Well, first of all, I was really pleased with the results. I mean, this is good results, great data, strong support for this school district from this community. And, you know, I'm the messenger, so I don't always get to deliver that. Sometimes I have to go to board meetings and tell the board that they don't like you and they don't like your district. I mean, that's my job. So right off the bat, there's strong support. I think, to me, the next interesting next step is, okay, there's support for a strong investment in this high school. And what exactly is that project? What does that include? My experience is it's about 70% how much are you going to spend, 30% what are you going to do with it. But I totally agree with this gentleman that if you get that wrong, that if you put in a project that people believe is frivolous or not needed, that can be a reason to vote no. So you need to be prudent with that. There's also strong support for the new elementary school. Now, I think when you do the math, though, that's going to use up most of your 130. And I think the park, is it Park View or Park?
Park Cafeteria.
Park Cafeteria. There's support for that as well. Can you get that under 140, putting all three of those together? I think that would be a great project. If you could do that. Bindorf? What do you have to do?
and ignore the tariffs on metal right now. Right. Back to that in.
So again, as Bill said, as Bob said, I'm really talking to the FPC, all your hard work, everything that you sifted through, you told us, expand the high school and build an elementary. We're not sure exactly what to do at the middle. We heard a lot of different things. Go ahead and test that, and it's exactly what happened here, is strong support for the high school, strong support for the elementary, and even our committee still isn't sure what to do at the middle level. So it reflects, even though we had like 30 people at these sessions, it reflects 3,300 people. Isn't that interesting how that it just corresponded almost exactly?
Shows we had the right people.
Yeah.
It really does. So at this particular point in time, you know, we have, you know, a lot of questions, you know, things that have been brought to us. We're going to be talking more about this at the May 14th meeting, because there's a lot of information here to digest. But the nice thing is there's a lot of good, strong information for us to look at. I think the direction pointed is fairly clear, but obviously there's different things that we're going to have to work through, both administrative-wise, working through with the architect, working through with the builders, and exactly where we're at. We're going to need more information, but it's a strong start. It's a very strong start. And this is all based on work that's been done for the last couple of years through the board, through FPC, through administration, communications. I mean, obviously, we have a lot more left to do on that, but it's been a group effort to get where we're at. We're not out of the woods yet. We still got a lot more work to do. I guess it'll depend on the economy, but again, I just would like to say the same thing George said, I've been saying in the past. Thank you. I mean, like you said before, Bill, this is a very strong result.
Good information.
Any other comments you have for Bill? Any words of advice?
I think for me, no. I think you're in good shape.
Just a quick question for Perry. For the FPC members, they're getting the presentation emailed, I think, today. Tonight, you'll have it so that you can take a look at it before Wednesday's meeting.
I have a question for Bill before you leave.
Oh, yeah.
You mentioned at the beginning when that 77% figure was there in terms of support for the or the positive impact that our school district had on our community.
Yeah.
When you look at this chart, the support for the different levels of the referendum amounts, was that as clear-cut in other projects you've worked on as this is, or?
Those two highly correlate, and I'd say, yeah, folks who believe that their school district is an asset tend to support their district. So, a district that has 50% that say, it's a negative impact, you might have 50% of those folks saying, I wouldn't support any referendum. There's a very, very high correlation between overall satisfaction with the district and referendum support.
That's what I was looking for, is whether that correlation existed.
Right. Yeah.
Well, good. Wasn't too bad.
No. Thank you. Thanks for giving us the information. And again, FPC members, thank you for getting to this point. And when I'm even thinking back about a year ago summer when you were brainstorming all your thoughts and ideas, and as that 100 million started to pop up, 100 million even, everybody was like, well, I'm not so sure we're going to be. But then as you just plowed through, you kept looking at things like, no, I think this community will support this. And wow.
You nailed it.
Yeah, you did. You were dead on.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill.
Thanks.
Thank you.
No.
I know we're going to be discussing this later on. It's tough to ask a lot of questions when we've gotten such good results. But as we move forward, I suggest that you channel your questions through George. George has access to the data, and he can break it down by different subgroups, by locale, mm-hmm. by geography. We've done that a little bit, and we've got some interesting results. One thing I can say is the support for Park School will be important for certain areas. And so I know that's something we'll be spending a little more time talking about. But
there was the reference to breaking out certain groups of voters. When will we have that to look at?
Whenever you like, just let us know what cuts you want of it.
I have a live
George has that.
Yeah,
okay.
Dashboard. And so what we thought we could do at our next meeting, where we have a big chunk of the night, I can log in and we can go to the data and we can manipulate it. We can sort it by community. We can sort it by age of student, where you have kids. We can sort it by lots of different things. Whatever questions you have, we can throw in there.
George and I did just a little bit of that, looking at the purple people for different communities. And we saw some interesting results, kind of reflecting what we have made assumptions in the past for certain communities. It still is that same way.
Yeah. And FPC members, we'll do some of that Wednesday night as well, go into the live version.
Yeah, in fact, if the board members, if you have that time available, that wouldn't be a bad time to come as well and
yep.
listen in.
Yep. Yep, 6:30 on Wednesday if you're interested, right here. Otherwise, we'll do basically the same thing next Monday night with the board.
Well, I don't have any other items on the agenda. Are there any other, anything that you'd like to add on for next time?
Just a reminder, next week we have agenda setting at 5:30 with our newly elected officers and our finance meeting at 6.
Okay.
And the regular meeting's at 7 then, right?
Yes, regular meeting's at 7.
Well, this will make it easy for everybody who has a band concert they'd like to go to as well. So looking for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, MCPASD.